In a previous video, we examined the ergonomics of two controllers for the Nintendo Entertainment System, the original rectangular controller and the Dogbone redesign. In this video, we will focus on the electronics of those controllers, the circuit components, and the signals that go in and out of the control ports on the system. I can recall looking at the plug for the Atari 2600 joystick in the 1980s and counting the pins. There were 9. Swapping a joystick and a paddle controller is pretty standard fare when it comes to the Atari. I thought that the 4 directions and 1 button of the joystick must each get a pin, so 5 total, and that maybe the rest of them were used for the paddle? I figured controllers must need 1 pin per signal to deliver presses to the Atari. I wasn't too far off in this case. When the Nintendo came along, I was confused. This controller has 4 directions plus 4 buttons, 8 total things you could press, but only 7 pins? How does this work? Let's talk about it. With all of the plastic pieces and rubber membranes removed, we can examine the circuit board, components on that board, and the wires connected to it. This side of the board is the side that faces us when we use the controller. When we press a button, the contacts on the rubber membrane bridge neighboring areas of the PCB to indicate a button is being pressed. Let's look at the back. The wires connect in the top left corner. You can see that the colors for the wires of the controller have matching labels on the board to indicate where each wire should go. The colors of the wires match the abbreviations on the labels written to the left of each hole. At the bottom, you see the label for the corresponding system, the Nintendo Entertainment System in our case. You no doubt have also noticed a second set of colors and system with each label in parentheses. This color scheme is for the wires of a Famicom along with HVC, which stands for Home Video Computer. Wire colors aren't universal, and this helps anyone that is assembling this controller by hand to know where each wire is supposed to go. The key component we see here is this chip with the label HD14021BP. As you may have surmised, this chip is an important component for taking signals input by us and providing them to the Nintendo. It is an 8-bit shift register, and we are going to learn how it works. Let's return to the side where the button presses happen. I'll talk you through the bright green lines called traces and explain the various signals. For reference and convenience, here is a single socket on the control deck. The control pad only uses 5 of these connections. The first two signals to talk about are power and ground. The Nintendo supplies 5 volts for power. I will sometimes refer to power and ground as high and low, respectively, throughout this explanation. Let's trace the ground signal first. Ground goes to each of the buttons as well as the D-pad on the board. While you may not consider the D-pad to be buttons, it is, in essence, a set of 4 buttons. Therefore, ground goes to each of the 8 buttons on the board as well as to the shift register. The legs of that chip are soldered to the board right here, 16 pins total. Ground connects to pins 8 and 11. So now we have our ground path. Notice that each of the buttons has ground in common. As for power, the power signal travels to the shift register as well as to one side of each of these black areas on the board. Each of these areas is a carbon printed resistor. More on that later. On the opposite side of each resistor is a trace that leads to its own pin on the shift register, as well as to one side of each of the buttons. We have a pretty good layout of the traces to the sides of each button. When a button is pressed, the side connected to the pin on the shift register is bridged to the side connected directly to ground, therefore grounding the signal. In other words, the signal is pulled low. So connecting the appropriate pin to ground is what lets the shift register know which button or buttons are being pressed. A fair question here might be, why do you need power and these carbon printed resistors? Why not just tie the pin directly to one side of the button, have ground on the other side, like it is already, and then when you press the button, it connects it to ground and activates the signal? The answer is, the pin needs to know at any given time if it is high or low. When you tie it to ground, it is low. If you don't tie it to anything at all, then what is it? The pin is floating. It needs to be told what to be. These resistors are used to pull each pin high by default. The resistors are called pull-up resistors, as they give the pins their default state by pulling them high. We use the power signal as our indicator of high. The resistor between each signal and power is important because we would otherwise tie power directly to ground whenever we press a button. If this happened, it would be bad. Don't cross the streams. We are set up quite well to tell each button that they aren't being pressed until they are tied to ground. With the path set for both power and ground, what about the remaining 3 signals? The names of these signals are different depending on where you do your reading. I am electing to use the terms latch, clock, and data. Latch and clock are used to ask the shift register for the state of the buttons, and the data line is used to communicate the state of those buttons to the Nintendo. The shift register can be placed in parallel mode or serial mode. This is controlled by the latch pin. When it comes time to get the state of the buttons, the Nintendo sends a pulse down the latch wire to tell the shift register to latch the state of all the buttons. You might think of it as taking a photo of what buttons are pressed at that exact moment in time. The latch pulse goes high to put the shift register in parallel mode to gather the state of the buttons hooked up to each pin, and then goes low to put the shift register in serial mode so it can send the state of the buttons out the data line in a particular order. The shift register always lines up the state of each button in the same order for serial output. A, B, select, start, up, down, left, right. 8 states, always in the same order, either high if they aren't being pressed or low if they are. Data, specifically the state of the A button as it is first in line, is immediately output on the data line. To advance to the next button state, a pulse is sent down our last wire, the clock, to the controller. The clock pulses each time it wants to get the next button in line. So think of the Nintendo as saying next each time it sends a clock pulse. 7 pulses plus a trailing pulse are sent down the clock line for a single controller read. After the final clock pulse, the single controller read has been completed for the current frame of video. With a basic idea of how a controller read operates for the Nintendo, let's build our own controller and examine the signals using an oscilloscope. We'll hook it up to an early 90s redesign of the Nintendo, a top-loading AV Famicom. Since the point of this controller is to allow us to press buttons and see what happens on the scope, I'm going to substitute switches in place of the buttons when building my own controller. This will let me activate and hold a button, but still have my hands free. I picked up a plastic container from a home improvement store for a dollar and some change. This will serve as an enclosure for the switches. I created a drilling template using a paint program, printed it out, and cut it to fit the bottom of the container. Just like our gamepad, each button, or switch in our case, will have the appropriate signal wire and a ground wire connected to it. I daisy-chained the ground wire from switch to switch and ran it, as well as the signal wire for each switch, out the side of the controller. Now I can build the rest of the controller outside the enclosure. I used 22-gauge solid core wire for all of the switch hookups. The reason for this is so I can strip the opposite end of the wire and feed it into this, a breadboard. Breadboards are used for prototyping circuits without the need for continuous soldering and desoldering. Makes things easier to change throughout the design. All of the holes on this top row X are connected together, and all of the holes on this bottom row Y are also connected. Likewise, each column of 5 holes is connected on either side of this trough. This just makes it easier to join separate wires to the same signal. Let's build the controller. First up is the shift register. It cost me about 50 cents. It will straddle the trough like so. The carbon-printed pull-up resistors from the gamepad are represented here by these 39K film resistors. Each button-related input needs a pull-up resistor with the opposite side connected to power, and each pin receives one. Both the X and Y rows carry power, so they are bridged to share the signal. Power is also routed to pin 16 of our chip. Ground routes to pins 8 and 11. Ground signals meet at column 23 over here. Now the controller cable. The wires have been extended using 22-gauge solid core wire. The colors are different than a stock cable. Ground, power, latch, clock, and data are now connected. Now all of the switch signal wires to their appropriate pin. Cable connects to the control deck. Launch control, this is Houston. We are go for launch. The switches are oriented opposite a light switch. Therefore, the down position means on and the up position means off. All switches are off to start. I oriented it this way so my brain thinks switch down means the same as press down on a controller button. Thanks to the shared columns on the breadboard, I can connect the oscilloscope probes to latch, clock, and data, and we can take a peek at what is happening as the controller and the console communicate. Here is a screen on an oscilloscope. This lets us view electrical signals over a period of time. We are going to break down a controller read operation for Super Mario Bros. Let's put a signal on the screen. Okay, this line from left to right is the latch signal. We'll talk about the specifics in just a bit. This line is basically a signal's timeline. time is moving forward as you move from the left side of the screen to the right side of the screen. I have set up the scope to always show the latch pulse right here on the screen. If I let the footage roll, you can see the activity. We actually have tons of latch pulses occurring as time is moving forward, but each one keeps landing in the same exact spot for convenience. Otherwise, they would just keep flying by really fast and we couldn't really see anything. All you need to note when viewing a signal is when it is low or high. See how the latch signal stays low and then goes up and back down in a very short period of time? That is what the Nintendo does to signal the 8-bit shift register to get the state of the buttons. I'll add the data signal to the mix. The data signal is high when a button is not pressed and low when it is. None of the buttons are activated right now, so data remains high for the duration of all 8 button states. Remember that the state of each button is output one at a time, and the Nintendo sends a clock pulse each time it wants the next button state. Let's add the clock pulses. The clock line is high. Each time it goes low, we pass the state of the next button on the data line. Remember the order of buttons I mentioned earlier? I'll place their order on the oscilloscope so things are easier to follow. With all 3 signals on the screen, let's review. Latch switches the shift register to parallel mode and then quickly back to serial mode, effectively saying, "Let's go, gimme A." Let's let the footage roll, and I'll flip the switch for A. Now that A is active, the data output is low during A's output time. I can now walk the line by activating B, select, start, up, down, left, right. Now, all buttons are active, so data remains low during the entire controller read. Note that this is an impossible state on a real gamepad, as it would require you to press up, down, left, right at the same time. Now let's turn off the D-pad presses. Turn off B and A. Turn off select. And now start is the only button being pressed and held. Watch the yellow data line, and I'll show you several states of button presses. No buttons are pressed. All buttons are pressed. Only start is pressed. All buttons except up and down are pressed. The entire controller read occurs over the same period of time. The Nintendo sends the latch pulse and the clock pulses. We step through the same order of button states each time, and those states are fed in order across the data line. That's it. Of course, in the computing world, time is important and very relevant in computer operations. Let's take a look at Neketsu Hockey's controller read. We are zoomed out a bit on this one, aren't we? The same rules apply for a controller read, latch, clock, data. But I am also monitoring a fourth signal, a signal that you already know if you have watched other videos on this channel. The intro to this game rolls through a few scenes and then hits the mostly white techno screen. This was the screen being displayed when I captured this controller read. So, boom, the composite video signal from the Nintendo. You are most likely already familiar with what is here. We have the last few scan lines from the previous frame, the vertical sync and blanking period, and the start of visible scan lines for the current frame. It appears that the latch signal fires the controller read while the end of the sixth scan line is being drawn across the CRT screen. Zooming in on the controller read area shows that the controller read takes about 2.5 scan lines to complete. This puts time into perspective. Not only does it take almost 3 scan lines to capture a controller state at the requested time, that capture window is a small fraction inside a single frame. If you haven't watched the 525-line analog video and Luma videos yet, I recommend you do so, as they will help define a few of the terms I use: vertical blanking, sync pulses, and more. If we examine the read as a percentage of a graphical frame, it occurs roughly inside this window when Hockey is rolling through its attract screens. Super Mario Bros. Has its controller read a bit earlier during gameplay, inside the vertical blanking interval, very close to vertical sync. Following the read, the remaining time for drawing the current screen is typically used to process the results from the controller read to set up the next frame. The vertical blanking period before the next frame is used to send the new frame's graphics to the graphics processor. It is this new frame that is the earliest moment in time where the results of the previous frame's capture controller press can be seen on screen. Let's talk loosely about input lag. We know that the controller capture window happens right here. If you press a button beneath that window of time, that action won't be seen by the Nintendo until the controller captured during the following frame picks it up. The input captured on the next frame is processed, and the results won't be seen until the frame after that. This is by design. Whether or not you consider this a form of input lag is a subject for another video. Concerning the time between controller reads and the location of those reads, it can vary from game to game or even game function to game function. When Nuketsu Hockey is waiting on the start screen, the controller is pulled at the start of each frame, as we saw earlier. When the game is underway, however, player 1 is only pulled once every 4 frames. I assume this is by design to accommodate 4 players. Now for a bit of trivia. The audio processing unit in the Nintendo has 5 channels, including a delta modulation channel that can be used to play DPCM samples. Mario 3 uses the DMC for drum samples, like the drums used with the dancing palm trees in World 2. Super C uses it for drums and orchestra hits. Unfortunately, there is a bug in the NTSC NES and Famicom where if sample data is retrieved from memory at the same time as a controller read, a conflict could occur that corrupts the data read from the controller. This results in the system thinking a button was pressed when in actuality it was not. This is typically a write press, the last bit of a controller read. To compensate for this, games that use DPCM, like Super Mario Bros. 3, perform 2 consecutive reads of controller data. Both reads are compared to each other to make sure they are equal before acting upon user input. Super C reads the controllers in a similar fashion. This bug was fixed with a PAL CPU revision. Finally, as a bit of an addendum, I wanted to show you 2 PCBs from later controllers. The Dogbone NES-039 controller I have with a PCB from July 1993 has the same size or package type for its shift register as the original controller, but also has 2 extra components on the board, a pair of resistors, one between power and latch, and the other between power and clock. An original rectangular controller for an NTSC NES is incompatible with the PAL control deck. You can add 2 resistors to the controller in the same places that are built into the Dogbone controller in order to add compatibility with PAL, and it will still work on your NTSC console. It appears they added this compatibility to the Dogbone controllers for the redesigned NTSC consoles. There is a much larger story on controller compatibility for various international consoles, especially in Europe. However, I do not own any of those consoles. A second Dogbone controller, HVC-102, has a PCB with a later date, September 1993, and used a smaller chip for the shift register. Well, I imagine we could go even further with controllers, but I think that is enough for this video. I hope you enjoyed this examination of the electronics of the standard controller for the Nintendo Entertainment System. I value your feedback and would love a thumbs up if you enjoy content like this. Thanks for watching.